On this week's episode of Portugal, The Simple Life, we start with a brand new series called My Portugal. Stories of how normal people came to Portugal, fell in love with Portugal, developed a relationship with Portugal, and how our Portugal became their Portugal. This week, I'm joined by Sarah Bradford, originally from the UK, made her way here via Dubai. And this is her story. Welcome to another episode of Portugal, The Simple Life. I'm so happy to be joined by Sarah Bradford. Sarah, all the way from Dubai, how are you?
I'm very well, thank you. Very excited and a little bit nervous. I've not done something like this before, so please be gentle with me.
It'll be fun, don't worry about it. Sarah, you are our first guest on a new series that we're going to be doing on this podcast called My Portugal, where we speak to just normal, very nice people, obviously, but normal people about their journey, about how they've discovered Portugal, how they've developed a relationship with Portugal, and how our Portugal has become their Portugal. So I'm really excited to talk about this story, but let's start at the beginning. Tell us a little bit about yourself.
Okay, I'm currently living in Dubai with my husband. We're originally from the UK, and we've been in Dubai now for about 7 years. We live here, obviously, together. We have two dogs, and my husband splits his time between Dubai and the Philippines for his business. So we have quite a hectic lifestyle here in Dubai. And last year, we were lucky enough to take ownership of our house on the Silver Coast, which we bought through Portugal Realty.
Okay, we're going to get to that. How how did you guys end up in Dubai? I mean, you're from a tiny little village in the UK.
Yes.
How was that change, and what was the what was the story behind that move?
Personally, I wasn't really looking to relocate. At the time, I was very much a home girl, very close to my family. And my husband actually went on holiday to Dubai to stay with a friend. I didn't go. It was a boy's holiday. And he came back and was just raving about how amazing it was, how good the lifestyle was, and, you know, the earning potential there. As most people know, it's tax-free. Structure here, so you can earn very good money here. So we decided to go for it, and it all happened very quickly. We both got jobs in the space of 4 weeks, and ended up here. Was only meant to be a 2-year plan, and 7 years later, still here.
What have you been doing over there yourself?
I work in HR. My background is in recruitment, so that was a natural sort of transition. And my husband is a bit of a tech entrepreneur, so he travels here, there, and everywhere.
Wonderful.
So, yeah.
Okay, so that ended up being a bit longer than what you originally planned, staying in Dubai.
Yes, I mean, initially we planned to come here just for 2 years, and we thought we would save up enough for a deposit to buy a house in the UK. And then I think, you know, living overseas, it kind of opened your eyes to other possibilities, to different nationalities, different cultures. And then we started to think about, actually, do we want to go back to the UK? Is there somewhere else that potentially could be a great sort of next destination for us?
Okay, so, I mean, how did Portugal first even become a thing for you? How did you first hear about it? What was your first visit and interaction with the idea of just knowing about Portugal?
Sure. I mean, to be honest, Portugal was never really on my radar when I was younger, when I was growing up in the UK. It was just somewhere where I thought that people go, you know, to the Algarve, probably somewhere for kind of the older generation to go on holiday, and people go to Portugal for sort of golfing holidays, that kind of thing. I think my husband knew about it because he's into surfing, so he knows obviously the surfing is great in Portugal, but it wasn't ever really on my radar. And basically, just over 5 years ago, I was actually diagnosed with colon cancer, which was it was quite a roller coaster experience that I went through. But as part of the maintenance that I was having to attend checkups every 3 months in the UK, which was quite draining, having to fly back and forth between Dubai and the UK. And the surgeon that was overseeing my treatment actually said, well, I split my time between Lisbon and the UK. So, you know, if you guys want to come to Lisbon and maybe make a long weekend of coming over for your scan and do that. So we were like, okay, great. It will be nice to have a change from, you know, going back to rainy London for checkups. And they're not fun things to go through. The anxiety is off the roof. And so that's how we ended up. We went to Lisbon for a long weekend. We stayed at a gorgeous hotel with I'll never forget, it had an amazing roof terrace, and it was right next to the Tagus River there. And it was just beautiful. And that was our first experience of Portugal, was a long weekend in Lisbon.
Well, a rooftop terrace, a hotel with a rooftop terrace overlooking the river is a good way to start. But yes. what were some of your first impressions about Portugal?
Lisbon itself is so beautiful, such an amazing city to walk around, you know, all the different hills and all the different areas. The food and the drink and the coffee, you know, three things that I love were all amazing. The quality was amazing, and we couldn't believe how cheap they were, especially coming from Dubai, where, you know, a glass of wine in Dubai will be about 25-30 euros. So that was a big surprise. And I think the biggest thing that kind of blew me away on that first visit was how friendly everybody was. You know, the guy that owned the hotel did a little itinerary for us and was telling us where to go, you know, the best restaurants and the best shopping. And I remember we went into the city centre and we were looking for a particular shop, which we couldn't find. And I remember asking a shop assistant, how to get to this particular shop, and they got out a map of Portugal and they were, you know, giving us directions, they were drawing on the map, and we just couldn't understand where they were trying to tell us. And in the end, they actually kind of escorted us there, you know, from their shop, like took us to another shop, and we were just like, wow, this is amazing, this kind of hospitality and friendliness that you get. I've never experienced that in any other country. So it was a great first impression.
The stories here that I hear from clients and friends, and that I've experienced myself, of people just going out of their way to help you, are legendary. I mean, it's just, I don't know of other places that this exists. You know, it's certainly not in Europe. It's just incredible. So that always sticks out for people, which is interesting. But now at what stage and what's happened in your life that you and Steve are now thinking we need a change, and Portugal is possibly that change? I mean, how did that evolve?
Well, as I said, we kind of probably about 3 years into our Dubai experience, we decided that, you know, we probably didn't want to go back to the UK, but we were thinking about where we could go. So we were looking at, you know, possibly Australia, New Zealand, Canada, but they were just so far away from our families. And, you know, Dubai to the UK is already a 7.5 hour flight, so we didn't really want to be moving even further away. And then the Lisbon trip kind of opened our eyes to Portugal, and we thought, okay, why don't we start looking into that as an option? And then started to look online and was really pleasantly surprised by what you could get for your money in Portugal as opposed to somewhere in the UK, and the quality of the build as well. So that kind of started the whole thought process about, okay, maybe we should think about Portugal.
Okay, so do you remember how that all started? How the first
yes.
sort of dipping the toe, how that all went down?
Yeah, I can just remember, you know, I'd had a really stressful day at work and I was just like, right, we need to make this happen because nobody else is going to do this for us. So I remember I started Googling kind of new build properties because we wanted that, you know, the nice new house, and we didn't want kind of the stress of maybe buying something overseas and having to, you know, do it up ourselves. We're kind of not at that level of experience. So we had a little Google, and Portugal Realty popped up, and we just couldn't believe the houses that are available. They were just, the design of them was stunning, and that really stood out to us. So I remember, you know, dropping an email to the info at email. I contacted a few other developers and real estate companies as well. I didn't hear back from any of them apart from Portugal Realty. I remember you calling me literally the next day, and it was a little bit scary because it was like, okay, this is actually happening now. We're starting to have this conversation, and you know, it's one thing to sit there and look at all these beautiful houses online, but then to actually start to engage with someone and talk about timescales and processes and things, it was like, wow, this is really happening now.
Okay, so let's just be clear quickly. It was the information and the idea that was scary, not the phone call, not the guy calling.
Oh, yes, absolutely, yeah.
I just want to clear these things up, you know, it's important, okay.
No, it was, you know, you were great, put us at ease, and you know, we just had a good chat about kind of what we were looking for, what our budget was, and then we decided the next logical step would actually to be, you know, to go over there and actually have a look ourselves.
Okay, well, if you look to my right, do you see that image there?
I do. I know that image very
that
well.
That was the house. That was the 3D image that you originally inquired about.
And yeah.
As luck would have it, that was the one that you ended up buying as well.
It was.
But there was a lot of other things that had to happen, you know, because as we know, it's not only about what the house looks like, but it's got a lot to mm-hmm. do with how you feel about the place,
yeah.
if it fits yeah. what you're looking for from a lifestyle perspective. So the next yeah. step was for you to come here, and how did that all play out?
Well, initially we had planned to do a cycling holiday, myself and my husband, because we're really into fitness and we like to be outdoors, we like to be active. So we had initially planned to do a cycling holiday, and we were planning to travel down the Silver Coast, stopping off at various different little towns along the way. We thought that would be a great way to, you know, kind of get a real feel for all the different little towns. And at that point, I think we'd planned to meet up with you at some point during that trip and have a chat with you. That was in the summertime. And then, unfortunately, my father-in-law got very ill very suddenly. So my husband had to go back to the UK, and we actually cancelled the trip. And then we put kind of Portugal on the back burner because our focus was, you know, the health of my father-in-law. Sadly, he actually passed away in the January, and it was a very tough time. I went back to the UK to support my husband, and we were actually waiting for the funeral to go ahead, and then we just thought, right, why don't we just go to Portugal now? We're here in the UK. It's, you know, it's a 2-hour flight. Let's just make this happen, because I think it was just everything that I'd gone through and this happening, it was just another reminder that, you know, life is short. You just don't know what's around the corner. So that kind of gave us the boost to go and do that in January. And we figured if we liked the area in January, which is probably the most miserable month of the year, then we would like it in any season. So we arranged to meet with you in that January. I think we were just over for literally sort of 3 or 4 days, and we went from there.
Well, I remember very clearly of the. It was very quick. The weight of, as well, I remember the weight of that decision that you and Steve were trying to make, and the importance of it, because of everything that had happened to you with your health problems, and to with what had happened with Steve, with his dad, and the weight of this decision was really, really heavy. And I remember that really clearly. But tell us about the, you know, everybody comes with an idea of what this place is going to be like, a perception mm-hmm. of what they think it will look like and feel like, an expectation. Mm-hmm. Tell us about first arriving in the Silver Coast area. What do you remember, and what sort of were those expectations met or not? Can you tell us a bit more about that?
Sure. I mean, my expectation was the Silver Coast is obviously the Atlantic coast, so I was expecting a very kind of rugged, wild, natural coastline, similar to Cornwall in the UK, and that was something that appealed to me about the Silver Coast, because as a child we used to spend every summer in Cornwall, so I love, you know, the huge natural beaches where you can have the coastal walks and it's completely unspoiled. So that's what I was hoping that the Silver Coast was going to be like. And I remember we picked up a hire car from Lisbon. We drove to Foz. We were actually staying at a hotel literally on the mouth of the lagoon, and we were both really engrossed in kind of following the sat nav and the map and working out how to get to this hotel, so we weren't really sort of paying any attention to our surroundings. And I remember we got to the hotel, and the car park is at the end of a very steep not a cliff, it's just a very steep kind of long winding ramp that you have to go up. And you know, we parked up, got out the car, and I'll just never forget, you know, the lagoon was there in front of us, and it just took our breath away. We just couldn't believe how beautiful it was. You've got this, for anyone who hasn't seen it, it's just this gorgeous lagoon which feeds into the Atlantic Ocean. And this was January, so it was, you know, clear, bright blue sky. The sun was shining on the lagoon. You've got, you know, the roaring Atlantic on one side and the calmness of the lagoon. And it was a really special moment. And as soon as we saw that, we were like, yeah, this, we need to be near here because this is just stunning. And we couldn't believe that nobody knew about it. We were like, this is just unreal, this location. Why does nobody know about this? So it was a very special moment. And I think that is my favourite place on the Silver Coast is Foz Lagoon. I just love it there.
Yeah. It is beautiful. And it's something when you look at a picture or a video, it doesn't do it justice compared to when you see it in person.
Yeah.
What were some of the other things that surprised you about this area on that trip?
So I remember when we actually went to the village to look at the particular house that we chose, what I really liked was the mixture of the old and the new. My husband has previously owned a property in Spain, and the house was on one of these, I think they're called urbanizations, and they're just these huge sprawling developments where every single house looks the same. They're all lined up, you know, horizontally, and there's just no soul. It's just soulless. And we got to the village. It's this beautiful little village, and the development is obviously within the village. And it was just this really nice mixture of kind of old and new. And I remember saying to you, like, how do the villagers feel about these new houses coming in here? You know, is there any objection to this? And you said, no, they welcome it. They see it's great. It's kind of bringing, you know, income into the village, and they're very receptive to newcomers, who, especially people who are wanting to make it their forever home, which is what we were doing. So that was great. And I remember you took us to lunch at the little restaurant in the village. And that was so surprising, because from the outside, it just looks like a tiny little, like a little bakery, a little bar. And you go in and they have this side room that you go into with these, you know, really long benches. And we went in at lunchtime and it was packed. And there must have been, I'd say probably about 50 people in there. And it was buzzing, everyone's drinking and chatting and, you know, having a nice, long, lengthy lunch. And we were like, wow, this is, to have this on our doorstep as well, it's great, because that was one thing we were concerned about. We did want to be somewhere a bit quieter, but we didn't want to be, you know, completely isolated without any kind of interaction. So that was, that surprised me.
Can you remember what we ate?
I think you ordered for us. I remember we had, it's a very meat focused restaurant, because it's mainly stuff that they've caught, you know, the day before. So it's all kind of fresh from the land. So I remember, I think we had rabbit, we had some steak, a huge plate of fries, a huge plate of rice, and lots of lovely local wine as well. So it was
They obviously thought you were too thin, because they kept asking if you wanted more food. They were obviously worried that you weren't eating enough.
Yeah.
Which I'm sure, as you've learned, has become very common in Portugal, that people are worried that you won't eat. It's a big thing. It's a big thing here.
Yeah. So you need elasticated waist if you're going to eat there. You can't be wearing anything restrictive, because...
Stretchy jeans. Stretchy jeans, the new technology.
Yeah.
What else do you remember from that sort of experience of the village and that stuck out for you? Because that was important. That was important for you both. Was how it felt, and there was something that happened there where you just, it felt good. So maybe you can elaborate.
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the comforting things was that we were able to actually walk around the development, and there was various stages of construction going on. So there were some houses that were completely finished. There were some that were kind of literally just starting, and there were some that were probably 50% through, you know, the construction. So that was great to be able to, you know, it's all very well and good seeing a photo online or a drawing, but to actually see the finished product in front of us, that was great. We could see what we would be investing in, and it was great to be able to actually walk around the building with you. I remember we were going up the stairs, and it was all kind of half built, and you were like, be careful there. But that was great, just to step into it, and we could visually see how much size we would be getting. And it was exciting to know as well that we could kind of tailor it ourselves, you know, because it is a turnkey property, you get to choose the floors and the tiles, and so that was very exciting. And we looked around at a couple of other places, but that just, it just had a great feeling for us. As soon as, I mean, you know how much I loved that house from just seeing the drawing. It was like somebody had drawn my dream house, it kind of plucked out of my head. But you know, when we went to see it, we saw the village, we saw how great the location was. You know, we had Caldash literally 10 minutes away. We can bike to Oberdosh Castle, and you're only 10 minutes away from the lagoon as well. So it just ticked all the boxes, and we were really, really excited about it.
Let's talk a little bit about the house. I don't want to speak too much about that, because it's so much more than that. We know that a lot. But you, I follow you on Instagram, and I've never seen somebody take so many photos of their home and their pool with that pink flamingo. But I mean, we know, you know, I know from our early conversations, you love the look of it, the big glass windows, that kind of thing. But now that the house is built and seeing the house finished, what are those things that you love so much about this house?
Well, first of all, I love the fact that it's ours. It's our forever home. You know, we have rented, I think we must have rented over 20 houses in the time that we've been together, myself and my husband. So first of all, to know that that house is ours, it's our forever home, nobody can take it away from us, it's a wonderful feeling. As I said, we were able to choose kind of the tiles that we wanted, and we've opted to have a few sort of little special things done that probably other people haven't done, just to really make it our own. And it's just lovely and modern. Obviously, you touched on the windows, the light that you get coming in is just amazing. And at different times of the day, it looks completely different. So, you know, as the sun's setting, you'll get the light coming in from the sunset, and it'll be kind of the pinks and the oranges, and it's just beautiful. But when the sun's coming up, it's, you know, the bright sunshine that's coming in, and it's just lovely. And it's just so nice to be able to, you know, sit in your lounge. You've got doors, you know, fully open. The pool is there. You can just dip in and out into the pool. I think it's just everyone's dream is to have, you know, a house like that with a pool. I don't think it gets much better than that. And I just feel like as well, it was meant to be. I remember when we actually went to look at the development, and the day before there was only two plots available, and probably I wasn't so keen on those plots. And I remember the day that we actually had the viewing with you, you let us know that a plot had just become available.
Yeah.
And it was the layout of that plot was fantastic because of the positioning of it. So it all just felt like it was all coming together. And
that was a crazy story, because it doesn't happen like that often. The timing of it, as you said, was amazing. But there was also another strange, or whichever way you want to look at it, coincidence regarding the number of the house.
I was just about to say that. So I grew up at number 15 Chapel Lane. That was my family home. I lived there all my life. My mum and dad are still there. And I remember the day when Steve and I got the keys and we went to the house. And even though it was plot number 2 throughout all the paperwork, when we actually got there, it was villa number 15. And I was just like, wow, how spooky is that? And I remember sending a picture to my mum and dad and was like, look at this, it's 15. It was, I just think it was meant to be.
Yeah, I mean, I mentioned earlier about the weight, and there's something that I've never told you and Steve. But when you guys had decided that was the house you wanted, and I dropped you back at the hotel, as I drove off, I looked back in my rearview mirror, and you and Steve immediately hugged each other, like this really big hug. And it was like, the weight of that moment for me was so huge, because I was looking, going, this was such a big decision, and it's such playing such a huge part of your lives. And that for me was just a wonderful, wonderful feeling to know that it was the right thing. But I know for a lot of people, and this is coming around to a question, but I know for a lot of people, there's always a moment where something happens and you just know that this is the right place and this is the right thing for us. Was there a moment like that for you, and what was it?
I think for us, it was the day after we had made the decision to go ahead with the property and, you know, put the money down, because that's a big deal. You know, you're talking about sort of life savings here are actually going now into something. So it's all very well and good, you know, looking at houses, and that's all very fun. But you know, it's quite scary when it comes to, okay, right, you need to put your money on the line now if you want to go ahead with this. And I just remember, you know, waking up the next day, we were still in Portugal at this time, and we both turned to each other and we said, any regrets? And we're like, no, 100%. And neither of us had even one tiny element of doubt. We just both felt in our hearts that 100% it was the right thing to do. We didn't have any doubts or concerns or worried. And that's been the same throughout the whole process. We've never faltered on that. We've always felt like this was 100% the right thing to do.
That's good to know.
This
has been the first time that we spoke was years ago. So this has been something that started a good 3 years back, and we are where we are today, which is for me is just a wonderful thing. But it's something that is so it's so synonymous with Portugal, I believe, is relationships and people and this connection that you have with people when you come here. Has that been the same experience for you? How important have the relationships that you've made been in this journey?
Oh, I mean, it's been amazing. Obviously, we have a great relationship with you. With everybody at Portugal Realty, and everyone that we've liaised with as part of the journey, you know, the lawyers, the accountants, the builders, the architects, everybody has been great to deal with, which is really reassuring, because it can be quite a daunting thing that you're going through. In terms of the expat community, there's a huge expat community in Portugal, and I've got so much support from you know, sort of Facebook groups and things, sort of posting, and everybody is so happy to help because they've gone through it themselves. I've made friends with people in the village who have been amazing. I made friends with a lovely lady who's got dogs herself, and you know, she took me to Obidos to help get my water bill set up. She drove me and Lola to the vet. So just people are so helpful, and they really go out of your way. I got invited to go for drinks on a Monday in the village. I think there's a football team that plays on a Monday, and then afterwards everyone meets for beers and kind of a post-match analysis. So I got invited along to that, and at the time I was there on my own. Steve had to travel for work, so that was so nice to, I think, especially after being in Dubai, where it is a very safe place to live, to be in a new place as a single woman, and to feel safe and to feel welcomed was really nice. And I don't think there's many places in the world where you would get that kind of welcome and safety.
Well, and I know that was important for Steve as well. Him having that peace of mind, being wherever he is for work, that you would be okay at the house in the village on your own. Which, I mean, that was never a doubt. You know, it's just a wonderfully safe place where we look after our neighbors. Sarah, you're now part of the village. Whenever we have Portuguese guests on the show, I always talk to them about their terra, because a Portuguese person will say minha terra, my village, my land. So your adopted land now is Obidos and Senhora da Luz. What can you tell people about your terra?
Do you want me to talk about Obidos or
both?
Sarah Deluge, both. Okay. So Obidos, well, what can I say? If people don't know about Obidos, they should know about Obidos. It's quite funny because I'm from Lincolnshire, which is famous for its castle and cathedral. And I feel, again, I've ended up literally 5 minutes away from this amazing castle destination, which is a huge tourist destination in Portugal. And it's just this beautiful town, which is built within the walls of Obidos Castle. And it's it's just gorgeous. It's kind of cobbled streets and flowers everywhere, and tons of gorgeous little kind of restaurants and coffee shops. And you go and you have the cherry liqueur, which they serve to you in a little chocolate cup. And then you down the shot and you eat the chocolate, and it's just, oh, the taste is amazing. And I just love the fact in the castle, it's coming from Dubai, where things are very strict and very regulated, and there's lots of rules about what you can and can't do. You know, you go to Obidosh, and if you want, you can wander all along the top of the castle walls. There's no health and safety. There's no one telling you.
They
you can't
do tell
do this.
You. Yeah, they do tell you not to do it after you've had the cherry liqueur, you know, so
right.
Because you don't want to go up there after too many of those cherry liqueurs. What about your village? Tell people about your village.
So the village is beautiful. It's a traditional little Portuguese village. There's a lovely little church literally at the end of the road, and it's so lovely because you will wake up to the church bells ringing and you'll go to sleep. Well, maybe not go to sleep, but they play in the evening, and it's a really nice start to the day and a really nice end to the day. It is very rural. I remember one day I was sat in the garden and I could hear this jingling and jangling, and it almost sounded like Father Christmas was coming with his reindeer. And I went to the front of the property, and there's a huge herd of sheep just wandering down the street in front of me, and the farmer's just wandering along, and, you know, he gives me a wave. And it was one of those, you know, when you rub your eyes and you're like, oh, am I actually seeing this? Yeah. So there's never a dull moment. And then obviously I think the thing that the village is most famous for is the restaurant, Omeru, am I pronouncing it right?
Omeru.
As I said, from the outside, it looks like a tiny little place. In the morning, they bake the fresh bread, and they make cakes, and you can have a coffee or a little beer. But then you go into the side room, which is the restaurant side, and it is always buzzing. I've never not seen it busy in there. And I think a lot of people travel from quite far away to go to this restaurant because the food is so good. And they're so welcoming in there. I took my brother and his fiance over last year when they came to stay. I didn't think that you'd need to book because I didn't think it was that kind of place. And we walked in and it was jam-packed. But they were like, no, don't worry, we'll still find you a seat. And they managed to, you know, find us a little table, and had probably one of the best gin and tonics I've ever had in my life. And my brother sampled their own beer, which they make, and cause he's a big kind of craft beer fan. And he couldn't believe the beer and the quality of
yeah, it's
food.
Good. It's good.
It's very good.
Well, now you know that people need to be careful about underestimating our little restaurant. You have to book. I mean, you know,
yeah.
It's just one of those places you can just walk in and go, hey, give me a table.
No.
But I've got a photo on my Instagram of exactly what you're talking about with the sheep. I mean, look at that.
Yeah. Yeah, that was literally...
I mean, that's walking past where the house is.
Literally my front gate, yeah.
Exactly.
And so, I was like, okay, I'm really in rural Portugal now.
It's amazing.
Yeah.
Let's do a couple of quick fire questions and just answer the first thing that comes to mind.
Okay.
What's your favorite Portuguese word?
Vino verde.
That's two words, first of all. Okay, Vino. So that answers what's your favorite Portuguese drink?
Yeah.
Vino verde. Okay. What's your favorite Portuguese plate of food?
I love seafood. So any Portuguese seafood is fine by me. But I would say I just love the fact it's very simple. It's very simple food. So for me, it will be freshly caught sea bass, just with some potatoes and garlic and some fresh vegetables, and that's gorgeous. And the pasta donatas as well. I can't forget those.
Okay. What is something that's happened to you here that you wouldn't see happening anywhere else in the world?
Oh, that's a good one. I mean, I think maybe the sheep is a good example. The sheep outside a brand new house, you know, on a housing development, sheep wandering along.
Probably, yeah.
I mean, we've touched on it before, but I just think how helpful people are, whether it's you know, professional people, you know, who own a business, or just general members of the public, and they'll go out their way to help you in a way that there's no benefit to them at all. It's just purely out of the goodness of their heart, they're helping you. And I don't think that would happen in any other country when there's not something in it for the person who's kind of offering to help.
Okay. Why is Portugal now your Portugal?
I mean, I'm so proud and enthusiastic when I talk about Portugal, and I think that comes across. Like, I do feel now it is my home, and I'm very, very proud and very happy to be able to say it's my home. I think for me, it's the feeling that I get, you know, when I land in Lisbon Airport. I have my little beaker of coffee as soon as I get to the airport, because the coffee everywhere else just pales in comparison. It's just the feeling that I get, you know, driving up the motorway back to the house. It's home for us now. And we can't imagine being anywhere else.
Wonderful. Sarah, a question that we ask all of our guests, Portugal, the simple life, why?
Oh, that is such a good question. I think for me, there's 2 points why the simple life for me. So my first point would be, obviously, I've kind of touched on some of the things that have happened to me health-wise and in our family, and that's definitely changed my mindset. So now I'm very much in the mindset that you have to live for the here and now. You know, this isn't a dress rehearsal. We don't get a second chance. You can't plan for things in 10, 20, 30 years' time, because you might not get there. You have to go for something now. So that's why I opted for the simple life in Portugal. Well, for both of us. And for me, it's the slower pace of life. It's taking it down a gear, but the quality of life. So you kind of, your pace, the pace of life comes down, but the quality of life goes up, if that makes sense. And the quality of life, it's all encompassing. It's, you know, the amazing food, drink, wine, it's the climate, it's the friendly people, it's the gorgeous beaches, it's the closeness to the UK for our families. It just ticks all the boxes. And I can't think of anywhere better to make our forever home.
Well, I'm delighted that you found a home here, and that our Portugal is now your Portugal. So
Thank
it's a
you.
beautiful thing. But Sarah, thank you so much. I've loved this conversation.
Thank you. No, it was an absolute pleasure. Thank you.
And now I'm going to let you call it.
Yes. Okay, here we go. It's a wrap.
So thank you once again to Sarah, and thank you to all of you. Please subscribe, share with your friends, give us a thumbs up, and please leave a comment or a review. We'd love to hear from you. And as we say in Portugal, Sejas Feliz. Welcome to the simple life.